Hi, this is Damian Marie Athope, and I am an axiological atheist, which can be simply understood as a value theory or a value science atheist, or understood as an axiologist, a value theorist, who is also an atheist. And I'm here with a friend of mine and a lovely guest, Margaret Downey. Could you go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourself and what kind of atheist you are?
Well, thank you for hosting me as your guest today, Damian. I really appreciate the opportunity to share information with your listeners and to provide an insight into atheism, secularism, and activism.
Wonderful.
So your first question was, tell me about yourself. Is that it?
Yeah, well, I didn't mean like a long thing. Just real quick, so people know, and then we can go more in depth.
Okay, well, I am the founder and current president of the Free Thought Society. I also founded the Anti-Discrimination Support Network, the Thomas Paine Memorial Foundation, and many other efforts that you might be aware of, like the Anti-Superstition Party, known as Frigatriska Decaphobia Treatment Center. And we have created some secular holidays and secular events, such as the Secular Day of the Dead. So if any of those strike your fancy, let's talk more about them.
Yeah, all that sounds very interesting. I also wanted to, so everyone knows how wonderful you are and all the good things that you've done. There's a lot more, too. But also, I wanted to know what kind of atheist you are.
Well,
I mean, you could define that however you want. There's no wrong answer. I just want, because everybody, you know, when they hear that word, some people think Satanist, and some people are Satanists, but not everybody. So I'm just saying that everyone, in a sense, when they have be an atheist, they can express that in a different way. Just wondering.
Right. Well, a lot of people say that I'm the nicest atheist that they've ever met because I'm very non-judgmental with someone's chosen belief system. So I have Christian friends, Jewish friends, Muslim friends, and we all are in healthy conversations about why I don't advocate their religion or believe in their religion. And I talk about atheism with my religious friends as a chosen philosophical life stance, and that it came to me with a lot of education, with a lot of critical thinking and reasoning thoughts that led me to become an atheist. And those healthy dialogues have kept my friends close and developed wonderful bridges of understanding between us. And I think that's what I advocate as an atheist activist as I go along my issues, my challenges, my lawsuits, to try to create this better understanding that we're not evil people, that we have more in common with the religious community than we don't. You know, I often use this analogy. I say, I believe in so many of the same things you believe in, I just put one more O into my belief system. I believe in good, not God.
Right on. Yeah, I believe in good too. I think it's interesting. Some people think that good requires a God. And I think, you know, yeah, but that's like saying that I can't value things without God. Because they think like the same thing of, you know, you can't have meaning without God. But that's like saying that we can't understand the value of a chair unless there's a God. Yeah, we can. It's something we can sit on. I mean, it's about a function. I can understand love because it's something I can relate to because that's a physical function, that a behavior that we do and that we feel. So to me, they when they think they can add God as a mandatory, like you said, if you just added the good to that, you know, really all you're saying is that we should have a standard of behavior, you know, and of helping and non-harming, to me.
Well, the things I often find that we have in common with our religious friends is that we value our families, our friends, our citizenship, our patriotism even. I have a duty above everything else. My duty to my country is much more important to me than my duty to a God. And that's why I don't think that God should be in any type of government affiliations or oaths or our money. People laugh all the time when I'm with them at events because I always carry a big black marker, and I do not exchange any type of paper currency with anyone until I have made it without the God, in God we trust. That to me is my way of speaking to our treasury department that God should not be a part of our currency.
That's wonderful. Yeah, I don't really do that, but that is a good idea. And I also think that it is important that we don't have religion put into, like, and I can't see how God's not a religious concept.
Yes. Well, I had, now I'm going to name drop a little bit here, okay. Damien. I had lunch with Neil deGrasse Tyson, oh gosh, so long ago, 2008. Yeah. A nice 3-hour lunch, and we chatted about so many things. I was looking for his support for a unity convention idea that I was building up in a business presentation form. But at the end of the meal, and I never go to a lunch without expecting to pay for my half.
Yeah.
As a feminist, I have always done that. So I pulled out my money when the bill came, and I pulled out my marker, and I started to mark my money. Well, Neil had never seen anyone do such a thing. So I explained it to him why, that it's not illegal to mark your money as long as you don't change the currency. He was fascinated by this. Well, years went by, and the American Humanist Association gave him an award. I guess it was within the year. Then they asked me to introduce him and help give him the award. So I made the presentation, sat down, and the first thing he mentions was our lunch and how I had crossed off the words "In God We Trust." And the whole presentation was hilarious. But the years later, maybe about 5 years later, I went to a convention where he was speaking, and during his PowerPoint presentation, it was one of the issues that he brought up, the fact that we are the only country that uses "In God We Trust" on our currency. And he compared other countries' currency that highlights science and technology. So I knew where he got that particular idea from, and I just relished in the fact that I had impacted Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Well, I think that any wise person learns from everyone. You know, I was thinking, you know, if you're a wise person, you know, you could even learn from a foolish question, you know, but fools don't even learn from, you know, wise answers.
Very good.
So I wanted to also say, so you had mentioned that you had critical thinking and stuff to become an atheist, or to realize atheism was the conclusion. So what was your upbringing?
Actually, I was born into a Catholic situation. I discovered my baptismal record when I was older. In my 30s, I discovered that I had been baptized Catholic. But the bottom line was that my mother, being a single mother, had tried to go to every single church she could, not to learn about religion, but because we were so poor, we needed handouts from every church that we could associate with. So 1 week we were Methodist, and then the following week we were Baptist, and another week we were Protestants. It was whoever was handing out freebies, such as food and clothing. Right. So I learned a lot about that, but we were also a very judged family because we were poor. So I learned a lot about hypocrisy in the religious community. They would give us food, but then scorn us behind our backs and treat us so horribly because we didn't have the things that they thought, you know, we should have. So I learned a lot about the different religions, but it wasn't until we had an adopted uncle, my uncle Floyd. As I was talking to him about inconsistencies in the Bible and the hypocrisy of Bible believers and different passages that I was learning, he told me that he was an atheist too. And I'd never heard the word, so of course I looked it up, and he told me, you should look this up because I think you're an atheist. And sure enough, I decided, yes, I am an atheist, and I did like that name. That was when I was 9.
Wow.
So I loved my Uncle Floyd. He taught me to look up everything, to question everything, to learn everything I could. He was the one that helped buy a set of encyclopedias. So I having someone who was mentoring me along without telling me what to think was extremely helpful in developing my ability to educate myself. And I learned that, you know, speaking up and talking about atheism was a healthy thing, because in high school I started debating my fellow students and my teachers, and I read Bertrand Russell's Why I'm Not a Christian and became armed with exactly why I wasn't a Christian. So it kind of followed through with that. I refused to be married in a church. It was very difficult. But when I became a single mother, I also refused to go to churches for help. I suffered through that on my own and learned a lot about being a feminist and working hard. And so when I married the second time, we were married by a justice of the peace. I became very interested in secular celebrations, which I carry on even today, providing secular weddings for our community, as well as baby naming ceremonies. So the goal of teaching myself about separation of religion and government became prioritized when I was in my 30s, and I sued the Boy Scouts of America for discrimination against our family. They threw out my teenage son on the basis that we had marked off the word God in his booklet and replaced it with the word good or science. So that was a 10-year battle, and it still goes on today, 30 years later, because the Boy Scouts of America still discriminate against non-theists. They allow the gay community now, the trans community, but they do not allow non-theists to participate, not even as employees or as volunteers. So, you know, we must be vigilant in proclaiming that we are the last taboo of the Boy Scout organization, and that must be changed to protect our children from being separated from and discriminated against. That's one of my priorities still.
Oh, I think that's a fabulous goal, and I agree with you, it needs to change.
By the way, your listeners could actually find my journey speech. I delivered this speech about my life, my journey towards atheism, at the 2014 Imagine No Religion conference that took place in Kamloops. That's how it is. Kamloops, Canada. It was such a great experience for me to be on this huge stage. I felt like I was giving a TED talk. So there's a link. You can Google it. Kamloops, that's Kamloops, Imagine No Religion, 2014, and then my name. And the whole journey speech is available online. But speaking of journey stories, I really want to advocate for your listeners to turn in some journey stories that we can print through the Free Thought Society e-zine. We also have it available in hard copy in a limited supply, but our e-zine goes to 7,000 people. And we find that the journey stories are so important to our publication because we want to speak in an emotional way rather than just facts and figures and statistics. We want stories that will tickle the heart and tickle the brain and lead people to a better understanding and could also lead those readers on the edge to become more outspoken about their atheism.
So yeah, I agree, and I appreciate, before we started talking, that you offered for me to have my story added.
We have a beautiful editorial team of 8 people, and they accept submissions. They are very highly educated people in English and grammar, and they perfect the journey stories to the point where some of our submitters have actually taken the final version and have become speakers in the community based on this perfected story.
That's fabulous. And that's really good that we help each other. I really feel that, we rise as a humanity by helping each other.
Yes, let me give you the link where people can submit their stories. It's ezine, E-Z-I-N-E, at F as in free, T as in thought, then the word society.org.
Thank you. So going back to your thing, so how was the impact, and you're talking about feelings for you, when you decided to come out? Was there a lot of pushback with your family or people that you were going to school with, or people that you dated? Was there ever really a problem?
Well, let's start with when I sued the Boy Scouts.
All right.
Because that really started an avalanche of hatred. It also was very difficult for my family because I kept my son's name secret, fortunately, for almost the entire time. So he wasn't directly impacted. But once I started making appearances on television, I became identifiable in the community.
Right.
And I have a different name than my husband. I've never given up my birth name. I think that's my right as a feminist to keep my name. I don't fall into that traditional of, you lose your name when you marry. So my name was different, but once I became identifiable, it did impact my husband's career. And to this day, we know that he was not promoted because of my activism. And that was hurtful. That was difficult. That took some healing. And, the time that we lived as an activist is very impacted by society's negativity concerning our philosophy. So I hear from a lot of people who were in the same situation. They lost jobs. They lost friends. They lost family. They became so impacted with death threats and hate mail. Some people have had to move and start all over. So I'm very sympathetic to those who have the bravery and the stamina to become a plaintiff in a federal lawsuit.
So How has it impacted you since then? I mean, do you still get threats or because I mean, I would imagine the Boy Scouts being a pretty big organization, I could see that maybe people would not let that go.
Some of the worst and most scary death threats came from Eagle Scouts. But I didn't stop there. I became a plaintiff in a lawsuit, a federal lawsuit, trying to take down a Ten Commandments plaque from the Chester County Courthouse. You see, my Boy Scout case was heard there, and when I walked in to the building, there was a huge plaque of the Ten Commandments. I didn't feel like I was going to get a fair trial.
True.
I was already being judged by the very placement of this plaque. Turns out that the plaque had been put there in the 1920s, but it was still very dangerous to have a government building broadcasting a religion, and it was the Protestant version of the Ten Commandments. So I got together with a woman here in Chester County, and we became co-plaintiffs. We had both been harmed by the placement of this plaque. So our lawsuit went through, and that was 2001. A year later, the judge ruled in our favor, and we were ostracized from the community. The plaque was covered, due to be taken down, and the mood of the community was so horrible that I was thrown out of businesses, out of restaurants. I didn't feel like I could even eat at a restaurant, worrying that the food would be spit on.
Wow.
So it was a tough time. The Chester County commissioners filed an appeal. And get this, one of the judges on the three-panel appeals court was the sister of Donald Trump.
No, I'm not a fan of Donald Trump.
I am not a fan either. Yeah. And I work very hard to figure out legislations and push back legally that we can formulate against the tyranny of this man. Anyway.
Wow. Really?
I knew we were in trouble when the other judge in the three-panel appeals level pulled out his coin from his pocket, and he said, "So, Ms. Downey, I see that my money has 'In God We Trust' on it. Are you going to try to get rid of that too?" And I said, "Yes, sir."
Really? Because it should be.
Right. And, you know, that I would not lie. I do not tell lies. So, you know, my attorney jumped up and he said, "Your Honor, this is not a place to have another court hearing about, you know, the pledge or the money. Look at her death threats." And he slammed the whole folder, which was really thick and large, of copies of the death threats. And he said, "The plaque is not a secular symbol. It is a religious symbol. Otherwise, she wouldn't be threatened."
Right.
And so the whole court was just, you know, up in arms, and people were booing in the audience and yelling, and, you know, the reporters were there. And so, sure enough, they ruled against us, and the plaque was uncovered and deemed to be a historical secular monument.
Oh, God.
Yeah, because it was, 80 years old. Well, you know, an antique in the design industry isn't even an antique until it's 100 years old. So I found that ludicrous, that a historical plaque could, pardon the pun, trump the Constitution.
Yeah.
But it did.
Well, so, and he wants to, so yeah.
So we were talking about going to the Supreme Court with this case, because there were other cases around the country, particularly the 5,000-ton Ten Commandments monument that was put up by Judge Roy Moore in the middle of the night.
Oh, Roy Moore.
That was around the same time that we had our case going. So we were talking to our attorney, an ACLU attorney, Stephen Presser, about going to the Supreme Court. And unfortunately, he had a brain tumor and died shortly thereafter. So we didn't have our wonderful attorney any longer to push our case forward. And the ACLU was overwhelmed with the Patriot Acts and all of the, you know, the terrible things that were occurring, mixing government with religion all across the country after 9/11. So that's where we stood on that. The plaque is still up there. But to counter the religiosity at the courthouse, we decided to put up a winter holiday symbol that could make our citizenry aware that atheists and non-theists were a part of their community. So in 2007, we applied for and were granted permission to put up a 18-foot high tree of knowledge. Huh. And on the tree of knowledge, the branches are adorned with color copies of the books that we non-theists hold dear. Different categories would be science, biographies of our non-religious heroes. We had history, technology up there. We had philosophy. We had books that people had in their libraries that they made color copies of. And the reason we needed two color copies of the book cover was that we put them together, we laminated them, and we used them as the ornaments for our Tree of Knowledge. So these beautiful laminated book covers were shining in the sunshine, and at night we had a spotlight on our tree that the book covers just shimmered in the spotlight, and it was absolutely a beautiful sight to see. But, of course, the religious citizens started complaining that our books were offensive, even though we put the Quran up there, we put the Bible up there as important pieces of literature. And juxtaposed right next to those books were a counter argument, a book such as Why I'm Not a Christian by Bertrand Russell. I've mentioned this several times. And even secular Judaism. You know, we have an alternative to the religious books that are out there. We just want people to know about them. So we started getting more and more trouble each year that we put up the Tree of Knowledge, and they passed ordinances that, you know, the tree could only be 15 feet, and then the tree couldn't have a sign, and the tree couldn't have ornaments more than X number of inches big. Of course, the ACLU was fighting with us the whole way, but each ordinance they passed year after year reduced the size of our tree, and it started to look like a bush. And so we, you know, they figured out a way to kick us out. And we've been fighting ever since to get back on the property. But the commissioners are using their legal power to restrict us from entering into this. It used to be a free speech zone, but here's the ordinance that they passed. They now own that property as commissioners, and they, and only they, can determine what goes on the public land. The public land is now deemed that there's enough representation for non-theists in a big fat Santa Claus, some reindeer, some candy canes, and a choo-choo train. So that's supposed to represent the non-theist community. Well, we object to that strongly because that isn't our mission, our goal, our vision of what non-theism is all about. But our books certainly are. So we've been fighting that, and the only way we can figure out how to fight back is that if the Tree of Knowledge becomes a more accepted national symbol, of the non-theist community, we can scream that symbols from other minority groups or even majority groups are on the site. Why can't ours be?
Right.
So I've had people testifying at the commissioner's meeting, people from the atheist military, people from humanism, people from the ethical society, humanist activists. I've had free thinkers, Hispanic free thinkers, secular Jews, all trying to show that while people want to brush non-theist into just an atheist category, that's wrong. There's a wide variety of non-theistic viewpoints. So I tried to show over the years that we are a much larger community than they imagine. But there's been no movement. So I have some evil plans in the making, but it's going to take another couple of years. And one of the evil plans is that we have to show that people are accepting this symbol across the nation, putting them up, insisting that trees of knowledge go into free speech zones. And we're trying very hard for the secular community to contact us. We'll provide the ornaments. We'll help them every step of the way. We have sound bites, talking points, press release samples. It would be such a great opportunity during the winter holiday season to get these trees of knowledge up everywhere we can. Las Vegas put one up, and we helped with that. The humanist helped with that. It was such a huge hit, and the media loved it. They were all over it. So here's a good way of getting media attention, by putting up a tree of knowledge somewhere in the United States.
Yeah, well, and I think it's a really fun idea, too. I mean, it's something that, because I think sometimes people think that, you know, children can't be involved in atheism or, you know, or like you said, non-theist type of, you know, events. Or, and I think it's a fun thing, you know, for children to read books in general.
Well, we have the bottom row, actually, of the Tree of Knowledge designated for children's books. And there are a lot of wonderful books out there written for the non-theist children and books that make you think. Books encouraging critical thinking skills for children. So we look for those books. We make ornaments for those books. We put them at a level, an eye level, where the children can see them. So we know that this is a healthy way to not only advocate asking questions and reading and education, but also that we are diverse in our non-theism, and we're nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. In fact, I had to laugh the last year that we put the Tree of Knowledge up that we were so restricted with. The same books that we had on our tree that were deemed unsuitable were on display at a bookstore around the corner. They were bestsellers.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think that the, people have an opinion of us that they want to have, not like it's reality. And they don't even investigate if what they have, that the negative opinion, is even correct. They just assume it is.
Yes.
Yeah, so another thing that I think is really interesting is that I've done street activism with you. And I think that that's a really unique little niche that a lot of people don't do. And I think it's just one more amazing thing that you've done that I admire.
Well, I like to get out there and meet people. I do a lot of tabling, and our table is so welcoming. We've also done street fairs right after we had our Ten Commandments lawsuit. I thought it important for people to see us with our booth, welcoming them and advocating more communication. But some of the citizens would scurry by us and actually spit in our direction.
Wow.
And yell at us. we went through a lot to try to repair our public image, but we stuck it out. We were there every swinging summer Thursday every month. We also table at larger events, such as just this weekend, we were at the Rally for Science, and people stopped by and loved our signs, talked to us, understood what we were doing there, advocating not only science, but critical thinking and reason and separation of religion and government. So we just posted some things on Facebook. If your listeners would like to take a look at our website, it's www.f as in free, t as in thought, dot, the word society.org, ftsociety.org.
Yeah, thank you for that again. So now that that you've done these things, you've also gotten some recognition in atheism or non-theism. You've been put in books and stuff, and you've done speaking events. I think that so you've I know you because what I mean is I know that you've taken hate from the outside, but I think that you've gotten some, in a sense, love from the inside.
Oh, yes. I'm so, so happy with the friends that stick with me and volunteer and take my ideas and run with them. Nothing is more flattering than to promote an idea and see it flourish, you know, all across the country in different groups and ask and be asked to be a mentor and to be asked to provide more information and the tools that are needed. Everything we do is online and there's no copyright. We want people to duplicate. We want people to spread the things that we have done. They don't have to reinvent the wheel. We'll help them as much as we can, because it's that important to us. Let me tell you about an event we're planning now for October. Several years ago, we got together with the Hispanic community and my friend Victoria De La Torre in San Diego, California. She and I developed the Secular Day of the Dead. And it was so beautiful and so wonderful. We did it again the next year. And now we're talking about doing it in Los Angeles on Thursday, October 1st.
That's cool.
I'm sorry, November 1st. Thursday, November 1st, 2018 in Los Angeles. I have a group talking about doing it in Maryland on the same day. Then also Philadelphia, we're talking about the Ethical Society hosting an event at their big building in Rittenhouse Square in Philadelphia. And I'd love to see this carry through to other groups. This is a wonderful way of reaching out to the Hispanic community, taking their cherished tradition and updating it to be secular. And not demeaning the tradition, because it's a beautiful tradition. I'm highly recommending the movie Coco to your listeners. It will give you an insight as to why this tradition is so important to the Hispanic community, because you're honoring your dead loved ones in a way that you're making them come to life again just by talking about how wonderful they were in their lifetime. So our Secular Day of the Dead doesn't have an altar. We have an honoring table. We don't have saint candles. We have philosophy candles. We encourage people to bring photos of their dead relatives or friends as an opportunity to talk about them and to show us their picture, to share their life with us. It's such a healing process. In my case, I felt it was extremely important to talk about an aunt that died, and I was restricted from going to see her before her death and to go to the funeral simply because I'm an atheist.
Yeah.
So that hurt at the time, but once I was able to talk about her at the Secular Day of the Dead and you know, discuss this with fellow freethinkers and non-theists, it was so cleansing for me. And I had, you know, stepped over into a mindset where I found a lot of peace in that I was at least honoring the woman that did so much for me during my life, but I was unable to see at her time of death.
That's heavy.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's fine. Real feelings are wonderful. So, or they could be terrible, but at least they're real. But right. So I really appreciated that you mentioned philosophy, because I think it's, for me, important for both. I think that science and philosophy both have value. And so I thought it was good. You also mentioned critical thinking and reason. I those are two things that I also have a high value in.
Well, speaking of critical thinking, I don't know if your listeners know about our Frigatriskaidekaphobia Treatment Center, but here again is a wonderful opportunity to grab the attention of the media. And on Friday the 13th, we find some place, somewhere, to put on a party or an event where we challenge superstitions and we laugh at the face of superstitions that are irrational. And we honor the superstitions that make a lot of sense. But we take that opportunity to throw this bash where we have our hosts dressed as doctors and nurses, and we cure the superstitions of our attendees. And we cure them with playing games and breaking a mirror and dancing, and it's just so much fun. Wait till you see our CAT scans. So we have a lot of props. We have a museum of superstitions that we put up, and it educates people about superstitions that they've not even heard of. We also solicit our attendees for more information about the superstitions that they grew up with.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, we have so much fun. And it's a good 3 or 4 hour party that includes a ghost pinata and ladder limbo and level the leprechauns. So this has been many, many years of planning and many, many years of collecting. I have an entire huge 10x10, it's a unit, a storage unit that I have put everything in. And when we're called upon to do a party, we rent a van and we deliver.
Wow. That's cool.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah, I think that's something else that the people think, that once you have no more God in your life or no more church, like, it's not fun. And I can understand, like, you know, when you're a religious person, your whole life is church. And so when you remove that, you think your life is gone. But, I mean, I agree with what you're doing. And life is not over.
And neither are traditions. And neither are culture. And, you know, that is what I think is so important with our secular celebrations. We do marry. We do have children. We do have these traditions in our different cultures. We can just secularize them. And my motivation for secularizing things was born from reading Sherwin Wine's Secular Judaism. I thought it was a marvelous way of approaching the Jewish culture and the Jewish traditions with a twist, in looking at them in a secular value way.
Right.
So Judaism Without God, that's a wonderful book for your listeners to grab and read.
Yeah, that's great. And I think I like the fact you did the Day of the Dead with, you know, secular. I think that's wonderful.
Thank you. I don't know where you live anymore, Damien.
I live in West Seattle now. I I was in California, but my wife had lost her job, and so we had to move.
Oh, I see. Well, if you have listeners in Los Angeles, I hope that they'll mark their calendar with Thursday, November 1st, location to be announced, but it will be somewhere in Los Angeles. We just don't know which restaurant we're going to use yet, but it will include food, music, the Day of the Dead honorees. People are invited to bring their pictures and place them on our honoring table, talk about their loved ones. There'll be a specialty drink created and maybe even a piñata.
A ghost pinata.
No, I think we'll do a
Sugar
sugar
skull.
skull
My
piñata. But
God.
lots of dancing, lots of entertainment along with the sentimental speeches about our loved ones that we are honoring.
Right, I appreciate it. You also, don't you do some stuff with secular celebrants or something like that?
Well, yes, that would be our wedding ceremonies. We even have a divorce ceremony.
Oh,
We have,
really?
because it's, reasonable.
Yeah.
People don't always stay married.
True.
So when we create these ceremonies, it's based on reason. We can talk about these things as reasonable people and go about creating an atmosphere where it's acceptable. Baby naming ceremonies. I just love doing welcome to the world slash baby naming ceremonies. And that is the non-theist answer to baptism. So a non-theist family may say, maybe getting pressure from grandparents to baptize a child, they can say, no. We do what we call a welcome to the world ceremony. And well, but some people say, oh, well, you've got to have godparents. No, we assign guide parents. We don't dip our baby's head in water. We welcome our baby and we have ceremonies. We say vows to our child. People are welcome to say their commitments to the child.
That's cool.
Oh, it's fabulous. I really enjoy doing it. The next one I'm doing is on Father's Day in Los Angeles. Well, it's in San Diego. So I'll be doing a baby naming ceremony there in June 17th.
Okay. That's good. So, do you have anything else you want to say before we wrap it up?
Sure, I'd like to invite people to visit our websites. The Frigatriska Decaphobia Treatment Center actually has its own website. It's the word Frigatriska Decaphobia, but you can press in Friday the 13th and my name, Margaret Downey, and it'll come up. That we also have the Secular Celebration site, the Free Thought Society site, which has about 15 committees that people can volunteer for and learn more about how they can take our projects, our events, our committee. Don't reinvent the wheel. Contact us. We'll give you everything you need. We love our non-theist community and our fellow organizers, activists. We are here to service the community. Please keep that in mind.
Right on.